So why did you make the switch? Because you've reached the national network level for CBS and ABC, very successful on the commercial side. What drew you to the public side?
You know, it was kind of out of the blue. I had watched the NewsHour or the McNeil-Lehrer Hour for a while, the NewsHour with Jim Lehrer. I mean, I didn't think in a million years, oh, well, I'm not old enough, I'm not, you know, I don't, the people that were working there had been there 20 years, 30 years. I'm like, well, they're not interested in me. And so by kind of a roundabout way, this opportunity arose, and I was like, okay, wait a minute. Let's look at what my life has become. And at the last place I was at on the commercial side at CBS, I was the Dallas correspondent, which is the sort of where Dan Rather started, and a lot of other people did. Scott Pelley, I think, did a stint there. I was just going from one hurricane to the next. It was almost formulaic in my head. You know, if there's another hurricane season, and it's been a while since we've had one, an active one. But I'll tell you the formula, and everybody's seen the formula. The day before the hurricane, it's the people boarding up their shops, and they're putting jugs of water in the shopping cart, and they're getting ready for this thing. The day of the hurricane, it's some guy like me standing in the rain telling you it's raining. And then the day after, it's we go to the home of someone who's just coming back to see that their home is destroyed. And almost in a cliche manner, they'll say, well, the stuff we can replace, we're happy to have each other. Lyft, 2 weeks later, different location, same set of stories. And it got to a point where, I mean, I have empathy and compassion for the people that are living through this, but I was saying, you know, I'm not really challenging myself to tell different kinds of stories.
Or to give more context, because you could put that formula on a lot of different
topics.
That's
right. Right. And public media is one of the last places where the audience has the patience, and so do the programs, to let someone finish their thought, right? So if, for example, on the NewsHour, we have often people who disagree vehemently sitting right next to each other, but they do it agreeably, and they do it about matters that matter night after night, whether it's foreign policy, whether it's U.S. politics, you know, about decisions that are facing our country, and I think that it helps inform our viewers. When this week we just had a 5-part series on rethinking college, and I do this usually once a year, and it's an opportunity to look at how higher education is changing. And again, I have friends, and I love some of my old friends that are still working in commercial media, but they don't have the luxury of time. All my pieces start at the 6-7 minute ballpark. If you wanted to get a 6-minute story on World News Tonight on ABC or the Evening News at CBS, that's a mini doc. You know, that's not gonna happen. So the luxury of time is something public media allows for, because I think we also know that our audience is generally far more intelligent, affluent, influential. But I mean, I also like to remember that our audience, I think, is they're comfortable with cognitive dissonance. They're comfortable with hearing an idea that is other than their own. Because a lot right now, I mean, what really works for two cable companies is to have sort of affirmation bias or a confirmation of your beliefs. If you watch MS or Fox, you're going to hear a lot of a specific point of view. But that's not the type of viewer that necessarily comes to the NewsHour, because they're going to hear something that perhaps might challenge their worldview, but they're okay with it. They're willing to listen to it. And that's a pretty rare and smart individual these days. So that's who I'm talking to, and I'm pretty happy about that.